Namaskar and welcome to Sunset Television. I am Vishal Dahiya and you're watching our special show Perspective, where we bring you a detailed insight into key national and international issues. Today we're going to talk about the aspect of rapid urbanization and the challenges and opportunities therein. In fact, India is the second largest urban system in the world, with almost 11% of the total global urban population living in Indian cities. In absolute numbers, the urban population in India is more than highly urbanized countries or regions across the globe. Now, the country has reached a turning point in its journey of economic transformation, wherein half of the country would be urban in a few decades. Urban growth is expected to contribute to 73% of the total population increase by 2036. Urbanization is central to India's economy, and for India to become a global player, urban India needs to take a giant leap, with Indian cities being well prepared for dealing with current challenges and a competitive future. Now, several bottlenecks and impediments, such as lack of availability of serviced land, traffic congestion, pressure on basic infrastructure, extreme air pollution, urban flooding, water scarcity, and droughts have been restricting urban planning capacity in the country. Over the last few years, various programs have been launched by the government to tackle the challenges and make appropriate use of opportunities in the urban development. Today, we're going to talk about all those challenges and opportunities. And for more on this, we're joined by a distinguished panel of experts. Let me first introduce them to you. Beginning with, we have with us in the studio Professor P.S.N. Rao. He is Director of School of Planning and Architecture. We are also joined by two more guests, Ms. Jaya Dhinda. She is Director, Integrated Urban Planning with WRI India. And Mr. Anand Menon, in fact, Vice President of Agra Smart City Limited in Uttar Pradesh. Welcome all of you to Sunset Television. Let me begin with you, Professor Rao. And let's start by putting things in perspective here, as our show is called, by trying to understand not only the need for urbanization, but also the rate at which we are, urbanizing our cities or landscapes, and the way we are planning it. Where do we stand and where do you see us standing, perhaps a decade later or maybe two decades?
Yeah, I think when India became independent, it was famously said that we are only about 14% urban. It has taken us about 60 years to reach about 30% level. So, which means India's urbanization doubled, the number of urban population doubled in a period of about 50 to 60 years. Mm-hmm. But it's not going to take so much time for us to do the next doubling. I think very soon, in about a decade, India is going to become 50% urban. So, as Mahatma Gandhi at one time said, India lives in its villages. I think that is not going to be the case. Very soon, India is, more than half of India is actually going to live in the urban areas. Mm-hmm. So what does this mean? This means a lot of challenges, whether it's water, whether it's mobility, whether it's housing, whether it is jobs. We already see that more than half of the GDP of the country is actually now coming from the urban areas.
Okay.
So while agriculture is important, I'm not saying no to agriculture, because you need food, you need all of that. But then the contribution to the economy, to contribution to growth, to contribution to development, I think urban areas have a major role to play.
Okay.
So how well you craft the urban areas, how well you make life a better place to live in, because people are going to move from the rural areas into the urban areas. Urban areas have an agglomeration economy. There is a scale of economy. So while there is a lot of rural poverty and rural unemployment, people are pushed. There are push and pull factors which bring people from the rural areas into the urban areas.
Okay.
So this will continue to happen, and we have to face the challenge squarely. And there are a series of steps that we need to take. It's not that we've not done anything so far, but then we need to take more concerted efforts in order to make our urban areas more livable, more sustainable, so that we can take the nation forward.
Okay. And then we'll go into detail into all those points which you're making, challenges and the opportunities there as well. But let's also bring in our other two panelists here. Ms. Jaya, I'd like to bring you first, and let's understand from your perspective how crucial or how important is this concept of rapid urbanization or urban development. We are moving at a very breakneck speed here.
Yes, Mr. Dahiya. I mean, the concept of urbanization, essentially, look at it from the standpoint of the concept of planning, really. Why can't we just leave what's happening to market forces, right? So basically, planning in our cities has always been a reflection of the prevailing cultural, technological trends, and even major crises. So if you look back in the 1700s, when machines came about and the Industrial Revolution happened, houses were built very close to the factories and overcrowding happened. There were lack of civic amenities. There was a lot of pollution. And then in the 1900s, we realized that we need some planning tools and techniques to take care of that. That was a certain sort of leap of urbanization that happened then. And then basically we laid down zoning regulations, planning regulations, the concepts of development control regulations came in as a way to protect public health, safety, and welfare. And now with the COVID pandemic, we seem to have come, yet another full circle with a public crisis, health crisis on our hands. And now human health is one of the most important factors that is going to influence economic development and urbanization.
Okay.
And therefore, finding ways to address chronic diseases of the 21st century, several of which are consequences of environmental degradation, is now going to dominate policy discussions and how we plan our cities.
Okay, fair enough. That is going to be a very, very important key factor. And we'll talk further about this and the other factors also. But Mr. Menon, you've been closely involved with the Smart City Mission, which is one of the flagship programs of this government, and also a very important cornerstone of the overall urban development, or urban planning, which we are talking about. What is it that is being done on the ground? What are the key focus areas of the Smart City Mission, and how is that being implemented? How beneficial it is?
To rightly put it, I would tell three key words to coin up this mission. That is the people, process, and the technology. Mm-hmm. So the smart city mission should be seen as a laboratory, how things can be done differently rather than the traditional approach.
Okay.
Right from the start, how the mission was set up, the complete top-down approach was completely changed from bottom-to-top approach. In the entire smart city mission, the entire plan, the projects, the ideas are actually created by the people, which is actually a people-centric urban planning or the people-centric city development, which has been aimed at. And the kind of flexibility, the kind of innovations that is brought in, the kind of first-of-its-kind initiatives that has been brought in.
Okay.
Like for an example, recently, under the Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav celebration, under the Smart City Mission, 22 cities undertook a placemaking marathon, mm-hmm. wherein 22 cities transformed an urban area in a matter of 75 hours. Since it is the 75th year of independence, that was the target given, or that was the aim and the vision given to the cities.
Okay.
Collect an urban area and transform it in 75 hours. Like in Agra, one of the busiest junctions, that is the Bhagwan Talkies Flyover and Junction, that we could transform in 75 hours with beautification, providing parking spaces, reorientation of traffic, etc. and all. So the idea behind that is that with quick, cost effective and quick incentive, how we can actually bring in transformation in the cities by involving the people, the stakeholders, and the various people associated with it.
Okay.
And how it can be replicated across the city.
Okay.
And that is how the entire 100 cities are becoming the laboratory, and which can become the lighthouse cities for the other 4,000 cities across the country.
Okay. So that's one area, which we were earlier talking about, and you were also referring to it in terms of putting human face to the development, people-centric development, something which Mr. Menon is pointing out, something which Jay was also referring to. But Professor Rao, how do we go about and, tackle this issue or ensure that it is implemented not only in those selected smart cities on which the work is going on, but also in other urban centers also? It's just not about tier one cities. It has to be about tier two and tier three cities also.
Absolutely. but then in a very large country like ours, more than 4,000 plus cities and towns, it may be really very difficult to implement everything everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
So probably we need to prioritize.
Okay.
So 100 smart cities have been prioritized. That is fine. But then that's just not enough, because 100 versus 4,000, there's a huge gap there. But having said that, I think the problems are more pronounced in the larger areas, in the metropolitan areas, in the million plus cities and the four or five large, very large metropolises. And there are problems galore, whether it is traffic management, whether it is water management, whether it is flood control. So I think a very concerted effort is required. A citywide approach is required to address each and every one of these problems, because you can't tackle flooding without tackling roads and without tackling traffic and without tackling mass transport.
The sewage system as well.
Yeah, the sewer system and putting all your cables underground and then ensuring that the people live close to the mobility lines. So it is actually a city is a package deal that one gets. So how do you put all of these together? And it's not one solution, but a series of alternative solutions. If you take mobility, for instance, there are different classes of people, and people move up and down for different reasons, whether it's for movement of goods, whether it's for recreation, whether it's for going to office, or a small child going to the school. So different modes of transport and different ways of conveying people and goods from one place to the other.
Okay.
So how do you integrate that with safety, for instance? Because you may have roads, but then you also have to have good street lighting. And then roads are not meant only for cars. Because quite often in this country, we've been looking at roads and mobility only in terms of moving vehicles. What about people who walk? A large number of people walk. A large number of people don't own vehicles. Particularly the lower income population, the large number of rural people who are coming to the
bicycles.
Cities. They use bicycles. Many people walk. Many people use hand carts and various other kinds of things. And then roads are also not just meant for movement.
Mm-hmm.
Roads are also not meant just for walking. Roads are the lifelines where people sit and work. And whether it's a guy who's doing a boot polish, a guy who's selling fruits, a guy who's selling vegetables. No, you have a whole series of these street vending population. So it's not a Western concept. The very Indian nature, that needs to be captured. And we can't ape the Western ways of doing things.
Okay.
We have to develop our own homegrown indigenous methods of addressing these problems in a holistic manner,
mm-hmm.
and finding the funds and the will to actually go ahead and implement that.
Okay. Ms. Jaya, would you agree with that? Finding indigenous solutions to the problems which we face here when we're talking about dealing with the challenges of rapid urbanization. And it's just not about making it people-centric, but also most of those aspects of urban centers being people-centric also have to deal with the concept of sustainable development. We can't just keep on developing our cities. They have to have a sustainable mode also of development.
Yes, no, absolutely. I mean, there's no disputing what Dr. Rao is saying about indigenous solutions. I mean, one, what can we learn from our own past history? You know, what we have experienced as a country, as a culture. But there are also lessons which we can learn from many of the other global cities who are in the same position as us, right? Because the climate crisis, the pandemic, these have all been global phenomena that we have all been exposed to and, we are trying to grapple with. And there are some lessons that we've learned, as the climate crisis is unfolding, as the pandemic has unfolded. One, that, we are more vulnerable and more at risk than we ever understood. And the fact that there's a stark division between those that have and those that don't. And, Dr. Rao also pointed that out. The second thing is, how we build cities matter. And, in the pandemic, in the wake of the pandemic, density got a bad reputation because it was mixed up with overcrowding,
mm-hmm.
right? But when you look at some of the global cities, like you look at Atlanta and Barcelona, for example, the population of both these cities is about 2.5 to 2.8 million. The urban area of Atlanta, though, is about 4,000 square kilometers, and Barcelona is only 162 square kilometers.
Okay.
And so therefore, the emissions per person are much lower in Barcelona. Are there lessons there that we can learn? Barcelona is also a city which is very famous for the way it has, put into place walkable blocks, neighborhoods, local level planning. Are there lessons that we can derive from there?
Okay.
The third thing that I would say is that, resilience, first of all, is something that we need to focus on. So far, the conversation has been about sustainability, and sustainability is very important, but we need to move that conversation forward into resilience.
Mm-hmm.
And, when we talk about resilience, it is about interdependencies of systems, of people, and a city or a town or people are only as resilient as their weakest link. So how do we build this individual and community capacity? How do we build that resilience, adaptive capacity is going to be very important going forward.
Okay.
The other thing is that, how do we move towards inclusionary policies and plans? This is very evident in terms of, for example, what happened with migrant workers in the last year, you know, and the bottlenecks that were faced during the lockdown in supply chain and logistics.
Okay.
So how do we do that? And how do we collaborate also between stakeholders is going to be very important for problem solving.
Okay, okay. The resilience of the community, resilience of the people living in the city, that also seemingly is a very, very key, important aspect. Mr. Menon, you know, several issues, and you must be dealing with these challenges, you know, while being at the helm of affairs at One Smart City Limited out there, dealing with the challenges in terms of implementation, in terms of planning, be it mobility, traffic congestion, or the issue of sustainable development. And you know, the latest one pointed out by Jaya here, resilience, because unless the community is involved, it'll become impossible for that development to sustain itself.
Yeah. So one thing in smart cities that what we have been doing here is that to take care of the sustainable development, like we have brought out a concept called this climate smart cities. So for the first of its kind in the entire history of our country, the entire cities, the entire 100 smart cities are being assessed based upon their climate friendliness, the climate resilience. And there is a 0.5 framework which has been done, and each city assesses its preparedness to it. And there are different ratings given for each of the scale. For example, in terms of used water reuse, or in terms of the green cover, in terms of urban biodiversity, in terms of renewable energy consumption, like the various parameters are there. So the first part was that each city knows that where they stand, and also they know the path of where they have to go.
Okay.
So that gap analysis is being done for each and every city. So each city knows like how much they are in deep water, or to what level they have to improve, and what are the areas that they have to concentrate on in order to get the better ranking, and in order to be more climate friendly and all those things. And to answer your second point related to the involvement of the communities, like this smart city mission is one of the mission where the core, the essence of the entire smart city mission is the people. For example, because as when the mission was launched itself, one of the thing was that everything should be focused upon the real claimants of the city, that is the people.
Okay.
So in fact, the plan of the city, the smart city challenge proposal, was in fact by the ideas that the people has actually formed. The citizens of each of the city identified what are the key problems that they wanted to solve using the smart city mission.
Okay.
And it is not one size fit for all. Every city may have different problems. A problem which Agra faces is not what the problems where the Surat faces.
Indeed.
Or for example, what Chennai faces. So the different problems are actually attempted in a different way. And through now the 5 to 6 years of the smart city mission, the basic motherboard or the basic framework has been created, which the other cities can actually follow and learning from the mistakes or learning from the various innovations. For example, one simple example I'll tell you, the integrated command and control centers has been established as of now in more than 75 to 80 cities. Now, as what is said, a soldier or an army is really tested on the war front. So this pandemic was the real test for these command and control centers. In fact, majority of them were converted into the COVID war rooms, which became the real nerve center.
Indeed, and I remember having this conversation with you and other heads of some other smart cities vis-a-vis the use of that command and control center. That's a very, very important point which you made, Mr. Menon. Professor Rao, you know, looking at this aspect, and everything is integrated, everything is interrelated when we're talking about making development people-centric, when we're talking about the challenges vis-a-vis traffic congestion or, you know, the flooding in urban areas or the sewage system. But overall, the development has to be sustainable and there has to be resilience. And then the community participation part, which Jay was referring to. How are we dealing with that vis-a-vis our policies which are existing right now? And if any tweaks are required, what they might be?
Yeah, I think it is only in the recent past that we've become more and more sensitive to some of these issues. Development has to be inclusive, it has to be sustainable, it has to be resilient. I think these voices are being heard increasingly so only now. That is thanks to the way in which planning and development has evolved in this country. We have inherited a lot from outside. So now we need to increasingly, as I said earlier, at the cost of repetition, I would say that we need to search for solutions within ourselves.
Indigenous.
Yes, of course, there are lessons to be learned elsewhere. I mean, it's not a wider road is not always going to solve the traffic problem. So you need to look at your own peculiarities of Indian cities and Indian population and Indian way of life, Indian climate and culture, mm-hmm. and devise solutions which will suit our levels of affordability, because we don't have so much money to splurge. I mean, if you have a lot of money, then you can really go in for the best.
Okay.
But then we also have limitations on money. We have limitations on our capacities. But the good part of it is that a great part of this country is yet to be developed, yet to be built, unlike in some parts of Europe and the US, where it's all done. So now all you need to do is to actually retrofit.
Improve upon it.
But in our case, we've not even done it. So the first time if you're doing it, here is a challenge, here is an opportunity for you to actually do it the right way. So I think that is where do it green, do it sustainable. And I think in the housing sector, there's a great opportunity. Millions of houses are being built. There's a global housing technology challenge that has been recently launched. So a lot of new technologies are coming, a lot of green technologies are coming. Ways of doing things fast.
Okay.
That is also very important, because in our country so far, we've seen projects taking ages to get completed. Yeah. So now that is all a thing of the past. We need to complete our projects on time. We need to maintain quality control in our projects, and we need to do it the right way, the affordable way, and the green way.
Okay.
So I think that is the way forward. And last but not the least, all these things have to be done with the government at the center, because while people are at the center, no doubt about it, but then the government has to take the lead.
Indeed. Not only in terms of funds, but also in terms of policy, in terms of decisions.
So the policies, the laws, the governance architecture, that is very important, because people can only keep cribbing about it. People can participate to a certain extent. But then large-scale urban commons, if I may use the phrase, mm-hmm. has to be government-driven. And yes, the corporate sector can pitch in. Private sector can pitch in. Academia can pitch in. Industry can come in. Consultants can come in. People certainly can give the feedback whether it is what we want or what we don't want.
Okay.
But then the government governance architecture, that needs a complete rejig. And I think we are on that path now.
Okay, wonderful. Mr. Menon and Jay, I'd like to take quick concluding comments from you. I'll start with you, Mr. Menon. You know, your response to this very important observation which Dr. Rao has made in terms of finding solutions, it should be a mix of the best of both worlds. From the outside, that is from other countries, their development model as well. But we have to think of indigenous solutions. We have to think about what is it that we need? What is it that fits our society, our country, our cities, and need of our people?
Yeah. So it's a valid point. And like to take on from Dr. Rao has said, mm-hmm. One of the good opportunity that we have is that majority of the cities needs to be built. There is a lot to be built in future. So why not we think the cities that we are going to build or the areas that we are going to develop from the day one itself, why not we think it is developed in a smart way?
Okay.
So developing it in a smart way doesn't mean that it has to be hunky-dory with all those hi-fi technology and other things. It can be cost-effective, frugally innovative solutions which can come from the citizens itself.
Okay.
One of the things, I think somewhere in some city of this Tamil Nadu, they've started with this waste exchange. There is another startup which has come with this innovative traffic solution by coming up with this mobile app, by integrating all those last mile connectivity providers and all those things. So we have many bright young minds, and by the collaboration, taking on from Dr. Rao said, by collaborating with the various stakeholders, the academia, the industry, the policy makers, and etc., many cost-effective and citizen-centric,
okay.
unique solutions can actually come up where the talent lies within us itself.
Okay.
And it can come from the citizens of the city itself who are actually going and breathing in through that problem. And who else can be the best solution givers than the citizen?
That's a very interesting way of looking at this as well, Professor Rao, that there might be a lot of work to do, and that might involve a lot of challenges also, but that also gives us a lot of opportunities to do it our own way. Jaya, your concluding comments in terms of what can we look forward to from here onwards?
Absolutely. So I think, when you look at the three main problems now that face this era that we're calling the Anthropocene, this, how to mitigate and adapt to climate change, how to protect your biodiversity, and how to ensure human well-being. Now, we can't use the tools of last century to solve the problems of this century and, you know, the future century.
Indeed.
So what are the things that we need to look at? I think there are five things that I'll propose. First is access to basic urban services for all. You know, closing this urban service divide must be a priority for cities going forward, come what may.
Mm-hmm.
The second is creating livable and connected neighborhoods. I think Dr. Rao mentioned affordable housing and also public spaces was mentioned. This is very important because when you create livable neighborhoods, they are key and instrumental in attracting talent and skilled workers. And when talent and skilled workers come in, revenues come into the city. So that is very important. The third thing is, you know, integrating blue-green infrastructure, looking at nature-based solutions, looking at ways in which we can build our next century infrastructure better to be more resilient.
Okay.
So what is a holistic approach? The fourth is basically looking at city region planning. You know, there are issues of, for example, air pollution, which you cannot solve at a certain geographic or an administrative boundary level.
Indeed.
So how do you look at city regional planning? How do you look at balanced regional growth? You know, which is able to attract and enable investments in, you know, even smaller cities of India and smaller towns of India.
Okay.
And the final thing and a very important thing is how are you going to leverage data and use it to inform decision making?
Okay.
Because you can't manage what you can't measure at the end of the day.
Indeed.
So how do you create this public repository of data? How do you use it to inform decision making is going to be very important.
Okay. Thanks.
And the one last thought that I'm going to leave you with, Mr. Dahiya, is this, and everybody, is that, you know, India, in the last couple of years, we've seen many, many successful public communication campaigns.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Swachh Bharat was one, Make in India has been one. And I think the next one for us should be Equal Cities, where we talk about access to public spaces and walkability for all.
Okay. That's very aptly summed up, Jaya, there by you. Thank you so much, Mr. Menon. Thanks to you as well. And Professor Rao also for sharing your views and inputs on this very key and important issue of rapid urbanization. A lot of challenges there, as our panelists were pointing out, but a lot of opportunities also in terms of huge areas, urban areas, which we need to develop. And we can do it in our own way to cater to our own needs from the perspective of our population, which has to reside in those cities. But two key aspects, that is, it has to be people-centric and development has to be sustainable there as well. We'll come back again tomorrow with a different topic. Till then, keep watching Sunset Television. Thank you.